Police Major General Romel Francisco Marbil is the new chief of the National Police. President Marcos creates the National Maritime Council as part of efforts to counter China's increasing aggression in disputed waters. A cybersecurity firm warns Manila is facing a growing threat from Beijing-backed hackers. We'll tackle that with Department of Information and Communications Technology Under Secretary Jeffrey D. And Iloilo City suspends classes for 2 days due to extreme heat. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. Our top story at this hour, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. names Police Major General Romel Francisco Marbil as the new chief of the Philippine National Police. Marbil replaces Benjamin Acorda, who retired Sunday. Marbil previously served as officer in charge of the PNP Directorate for Comptrollership and director of PNP Regional Office 8. He also headed the Highway Patrol Group.
Ang pangarap ko ay pangarap nyo rin. Patatag na ekonomiya, maayos na lipunan, at maayos na kapulisan. Yan po ang unang katagaan ng sinabi ng ating Presidente during the inauguration. Ang masasabi ko po sa inyong Excellency, Sir, matutupad po. As the 30th Chief of the Philippine National Police, it is my intention to build on the strides made so far to ensure that there is both continuity and improvement, that the PNP remains effective at its job while evolving to become a modern Filipino police force for a modern Filipino society.
Marbil is scheduled to retire February of 2025. In other news, the Philippines continues to boost its maritime security as China steps up its aggression. President Marcos signed an executive order creating the National Maritime Council, which will be headed by Executive Secretary Lucas Bersamin. It will be composed of several government agencies, including the National Security Council and the Department of National Defense. It will be responsible for formulating policies and strategies that will safeguard Philippine waters. Well, from one analyst, the recent incidents of harassment at sea by China may have pushed the Marcos administration to take another step in protecting Filipinos in the West Philippine Sea.
The reason why it was expanded from coastal to maritime council is that because of the series of events that happened this month. And I think the executive order number 57 will help us to uphold the fundamental rights of Filipinos to live in peace and freedom and free from fear of violence and threat. The imminence of threat here was highlighted in the new executive order.
A retired Supreme Court Associate Justice slams the supposed gentleman's agreement between former President Rodrigo Duterte and Chinese President Xi Jinping. Former presidential spokesman Harry Roque earlier claimed the two leaders struck a verbal deal during Duterte's term to maintain the status quo in Ayungan Shoal. Manila's sole military outpost, the rusting BRP Sierra Madre, is located there. The ship has served as the flashpoint of tensions between Beijing and Manila. For retired Justice Antonio Carpio, the alleged deal is against national interest. He calls it a disguised surrender of the country's exclusive rights over the West Philippine Sea.
Yung pumayag si Duterte na hindi tayo mag-repair, that's against our interest. Kasi anytime it can collapse. So pag yun ang gusto ng China, mag-collapse, tapos wala na tayo. Pumayag siya, he entered into the gentleman's agreement na may ruling na, nasabi ng ruling, yung Ayungin Shoal, atin yan, part of our exclusive economic zone. Pag ganyan, we have the exclusive right to put up a structure there. Walang, hindi pwede maglagay ng struktura yung China. Hindi pwede tayo sabihin ng China na wag kayo magtayo ng structure dyan. Atin yan in terms of exploiting the natural resources, no? That's within our exclusive economic zone. Pero binaliwala niya yung arbitral award. Ang problema lang, hindi na siya presidente. Tingin ko, impeachable offense niya. Kaya lang, wala na siya.
Journalists pushing back after a Chinese official accused them of manipulating videos of recent maritime encounters between Manila and Beijing. See, last week, Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesperson Hua Chunying claimed Journalists taking part in resupply missions are making sensational news to paint the Philippines as a victim of Chinese harassment. Several groups have issued statements taking offense to China's claims. Among them, the Foreign Correspondents Association of the Philippines, which called Beijing's accusations a barefaced lie.
Never kaming sinabihan na, oh, i-cut nyo to, ito yung dapat angulo nyo, i-edit nyo to. I'm not also saying that our relationship with the Philippine government has been all rosy, no? But at least we can say, I think, on the West Philippine Sea front, that it has been professional. For the sake of transparency, the most that the government organizes is a kind of post-processing session after the mission, where we all share what we saw from different angles to corroborate the facts. We don't take sides with any single entity, we just take the side of the truth. And it just so happens in this issue, the truth is not on China's side.
Under the Marcos administration, journalists are regularly embedded in resupply missions in the West Philippine Sea as part of government's transparency campaign. Well, several tragedies mar the observance of the Holy Week in the Philippines. Authorities recorded over a dozen deaths, 19 of which were drowning incidents, including an 8-year-old in Leyte. The Calabarzon region saw the highest number of fatalities, with 7 deaths reported. Meanwhile, separate vehicular accidents killed 2 people in Bulacan, while 2 more were injured in Region 5. Well, travelers returning to Metro Manila following the Holy Week break, around 126,000 passengers flocked to the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange on Easter Sunday. Authorities there are expecting the number of passengers to further increase today, Monday, to as much as 135,000. Meanwhile, bus terminals in Cubao, Quezon City also filled with passengers returning from provinces. Police and MMDA personnel were deployed along EDSA to ensure traffic management as well as the safety and security of passengers. Some passengers in bus terminals in Manila, meanwhile, complained about the long travel during the Holy Week. Some said their usual 14-hour travel was extended to 20 hours due to traffic congestion. Well, shifting now to sports, Filipino tennis ace Alex Ayala continues to impress on the world stage as she and her doubles partner bagged an ITF tournament in France. Diane Castillo now joins us with details. Diane, go ahead.
Hi, Carmina. Yes, it was a super victorious Easter weekend for Filipina tennis sensation Alex Ayala and her partner from France, Estelle Cancino. The pair was unseeded at the $75,000 ITF tournament in Bourbouge, France, but they upset the top seeds in the finals, Jessica Ponchet of France and Maya Lumsden of Great Britain, in 2 close sets, 7-5, 7-6. They emerged champions in the tournament. What was really impressive is that the ranking of Ayala and Cancino are not really that high in doubles. Ayala is ranked 305 in the WTA doubles ranking, and her partner Cancino 146, while their opponents, Ponchet, is ranked 151 and is a regular at the French Open doubles main draw. Her partner Lumsden is also inside the top 100, ranked 77, was a doubles quarterfinalist in last year's Wimbledon. So definitely it was a very, very big upset for the Filipina and her French partner, and for sure their world rankings in doubles will go up. Now, on their way to the finals, they also had some really good wins. In the round of 16, they beat Celine Nayef of Switzerland and her partner Sombari of India in 3 sets, 5-7, 6-2, 10-6. In the quarterfinals, they easily beat Appleton of Great Britain and Haverlaag of the Netherlands, 6-4, 6-love. And then they had another convincing win in the semifinals against the pair of Kira Pavlova of Russia and Marie Vakeri of Luxembourg, 6-3, 6-3. So this is the second doubles professional title that Alex Ayala has won in 2024. In January, she and her doubles partner, Daria Semisaho of Latvia, also won a ITF W50 tournament in India. Now, the singles ranking of Alex also continues to climb. She is at an all-time high of 171. And the victory this weekend was extra special because it was the birthday of her mom, Riza. So she dedicated the win to her mom. Her dad, Mike Ayala, was also in the crowd alongside her coach, Danny DeRocha. So definitely a very happy Ayala family over the Easter weekend. And some really good news for Philippine sports. Carmina?
Thanks a lot. Our very own Diane Castillo there joining us on the line. Well, back here in the newsroom, going back to one of our top stories, as Beijing's aggression against Manila continues at sea, a Texas-based cybersecurity firm warns the Philippines also faces growing cyber threats from China-backed hackers. In its 2024 Global Threat Report, CrowdStrike said these Chinese hackers are now using generative artificial intelligence for surveillance and intellectual property theft in Southeast Asia. To discuss this issue, we're now joined by Department of Information and Communications Technology Undersecretary Jeffrey D. Undersecretary, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today and welcome to the program.
Good afternoon, Carmina, and to all the viewers.
All right. So first off, let's talk about cyber attacks in general, because it can be both personal and on a large scale, correct?
That is correct, yes.
All right. So here in the Philippines, how would you now characterize the acceleration of these cases, both on a personal and large scale level, as we speak on both fronts, both personal and large scale? Go ahead, Undersecretary.
On the personal scale, I think that is more nearer to the sympathies of the public. I think we need to empower the PNP, the Cybercrime Investigation Coordinating Center, and the FBI in order to apprehend scammers or fraudsters using cybersecurity or using cyberspace as their modus operandi, where they operate illegally. And the people knows more about this, like phishing, scamming, etc. However, the Department of Information and Communications Technology, along with the National Cybersecurity Interagency Committee, chaired by the Executive Secretary, is also more focused on the large-scale attacks by professionals, let's call them advanced persistent threat groups or professional groups, usually backed by state actors. When they try to attack not only our own government systems, but also large companies that are operating in cyberspace. Most of these are critical information infrastructures like our power, water, even dam operations, etc.
Do you then agree with what CrowdStrike said in its 2024 Global Threat Report, stating that there is an acceleration being noted here? In the Philippines in particular, do you see that as well?
Yes, we see an acceleration of cyber attacks in the Philippines. It started with last year. Our threat report also shows that there will be an increase in misinformation and disinformation using social media, especially TikTok, Facebook. I'm sorry for calling them out.
No, call them out because we've been calling them out for a long time already, and the responsibility really lies on them. And it seems like it's been falling on deaf ears. So go ahead, Undersecretary.
So yes, a lot of disinformation is going to increase in the social media sites, especially in Facebook and in TikTok, going to the 2025 elections. You will see this already being practiced or experimented on journalists. There are a lot of robocalls or fake videos being generated, mimicking journalists and even our past presidents and our incumbent presidents. And we advise the public to be more vigilant with disinformation and misinformation. Please do not use Facebook. Please do not use TikTok as your source of news. I would rather that you still watch ANC, that you still go through the legal, real news and journalists channels.
Thanks for the plug and thanks for the vote of confidence there, Undersecretary. But first, tie it up to us, tie it up for us nicely here, because you know you talk about misinformation and disinformation, and you talk about a generative AI and the use of that. And you also talk about usually state actors or state-backed actors being responsible for this. So what is the motivation here? If it's an out-of-the-country adversary using generative AI to spread misinformation and disinformation, what is their motivation?
The motivation is usually to affect the outcome of the election in order to put leaders who are more sympathetic to their cause. I'm not singling out any particular state, but this had already been called out not only by other countries, by our allies like the United States, Japan, and Australia, but even the United Nations have already sounded the alarm on misinformation and disinformation. This is an ancient tactic. Let me just say that since the ancient times, adversaries use misinformation and disinformation. However, because we are now in the information age, it becomes easier and faster to spread misinformation and disinformation using deep fakes and fake videos. Again, let me reiterate that this is very hard to combat because people are usually accustomed to watching in their free time. They just, you know, scroll and look at these videos. So let's really be very careful. I think we need to form an alliance with the more bona fide journalists and those with integrity. We should also, you know, flood Facebook. We should also flood social media as our means of information. But let's put our face there, no? Let's give the public an alternative, saying that true news or news with integrity comes with a face, like the face of Ms. Carmina here, or the face of a real journalist who is putting their lives on the line and their integrity on the line by delivering news. Most of the misinformation, disinformation actually hides their true identity.
Oh, for sure. Because, you know, at the heart of it is, you know, escaping accountability for the lies that they spread. But tell us about the correlation here between the scams that people fall for and falling for misinformation and disinformation. Would you say, or do you think that there is a correlation between the two, as if falling for a scam is just a test if you're going to fall for that, and then you go up a notch and spread the lies and the disinformation and misinformation, and then you're going to fall for that even further? Go ahead, Mr. Secretary.
That's correct, Carmina. If you look at the cyber criminals, they're working as an enterprise. Gone are the days when criminals roam the streets. They're like blue-collar jobs. They put a knife at your they point a knife at you so that they can take your money. Now it's an entire enterprise. They're all white-collar jobs. They have an entire building somewhere in Eastern Europe or somewhere here in Asia, even Southeast Asia. And they employ people with high level of education who are willing to make fast bucks or fast money in order to do this operation. Some are even hiding behind our POGO industry. No? So what they do is that they create this using generative AI also. They create an entire enterprise. And then what they do is they commercialize little bits of it. They sell these pieces of code to those enterprising enough. And even students can use it. We actually detected some locals who are using these tools created by advanced persistent threat actors so that they can practice how good it is. So you're right, Carmina. They're using these bits and pieces of software that they develop, they sell it so that they can try out if it is effective. But actually, they're holding the entire machinery, these enterprises, these advanced persistent threat groups. These groups are they have a very high budget. Actually, the budget is even higher than the ICT in most cases. So they really are very... They are operating as a business.
It's just a department, one of the many departments that they have. That's what you're
saying. There is now phishing as a service. There's even ransomware as a service. There is also the attack on HOR just a few weeks ago, which was announced by HOR themselves. After our investigation, it seems that they used a denial of service as a service. So you pay in order to attack HOR.
Who's the likely culprit here?
In the case of HOR, we're still looking at leads. In the case of the other attacks, where most of the attacks, we can see that they are local actors.
Local actors with no links abroad?
That we don't know yet. But let me also sound an appeal to these local actors. Please do not act willingly or unwillingly. In most cases, I think they're acting unwillingly. They just are playing based on their what do you call that? They wanted to be known to the public as good hackers. Mm. Please do not play to the games of geopolitics. And if you really wanted to test your skills, don't target government services here in the Philippines. And I would rather you test your skills in a safer place.
Have we gone to that point? Have we come to that point, Undersecretary D, that there is no other way but to include geopolitics in the mix here, that you really can't isolate it? And if we've come to that point, what is making you say so? Go ahead.
Yes. If you look at the trends, usually the attacks increase when there is an important event that affects geopolitics. For example, attacks increase when the Presidential International Trade Mission went into the country, and in that particular week or the weeks following that, you see a spike in the attacks that we are detecting. Also, you will notice that there has been a multitude of attacks targeting the Philippine Coast Guard. Well, again, I do not want to put any attribution to any particular country, but these are facts. And usually this happens when there is also an increase in the tensions in the West Philippine Sea. Whoever is doing this, if it is Chinese threat actors or Chinese activists who are sentimental to the position of the Chinese, or maybe some other players who are trying to put confusion into the mix. But definitely there is a correlation with geopolitics and cyber security and cyber attacks.
Because what's in it for them? Whoever it is, if it's a state-backed actor here, and you say the threats increase whenever there's an important event here in the Philippines, but we're particularly looking at 2025, and beyond that, it's 2028, and you said earlier on that the motivation here is some sort of control, correct?
Correct.
So that they will get their way in the end. But is it something that is... very, very clear to you that this is what they want, that everything that you have now in terms of evidence is that control. But control over us for what?
So when it comes to disinformation and misinformation, it's very clear they wanted to control public sentiment because it's all about propaganda. There are times when a particular case is losing. For example, I just heard your previous segment about the West Philippine Sea, and obviously the Philippines is winning, has the upper hand when it comes to information, simply because we're telling the truth. And people believe that truth, not only here in the Philippines, but abroad. In order to overturn that, they have to create, there should be a certain scenario where this truth is supplanted by, like I said, by misinformation and disinformation. That's one thing. Another is usually the attacks are done also by activists. They're putting a point. For example, if there is they're attacking HOR, there was an attack on HOR when there was an increase when there is a public sentiment on, you know, when there is a debate about CHACHA or charter change. So some local activists are also feeling more involved. And some of these activists are cyber security professionals who wanted to show government that, you know, we don't agree to this, so therefore we're attacking HOR. Let me just reiterate, these are all, when you look at it, the motivations are either criminal, which means to defraud, get money, but usually when the attack is not criminal, is not about money, the attack is usually about creating propaganda or creating a message. Okay, so that's one, either by cyber activists or by state actors. And number two, espionage. The attack on we call it cyber espionage, not really espionage in the sense of the word, but trying to get information about certain aspects of our government services, like email exchanges, etc.
All right. You've painted quite a picture, I must say, and it's a very concerning picture. But then if you talk about state-backed actors, you also mentioned, you know, all these social media giants. Is it possible to actually win this war without their help, without any accountability from their end?
It is possible, but it will be it will be an uphill battle. So we really wanted them to exercise more responsibility in checking for information and misinformation. For example, and sorry to say if they already know if it is chismis or it is in our colloquial term chismis, right? They already know if it is rumor mongering.
Mm-hmm.
They already know if it is a personal attack, whether it's a personal attack on the first family, whether it's a personal attack on a particular political figure, etc. Mm-hmm. You know for a fact if it is a personal attack. Then why
They're earning from it. The reason why it spreads like wildfire is because they're boosting it, they're paying for it, therefore they're earning from it. Why would they choke their own revenue stream?
But the revenue is already larger than GDPs of most small to medium scale countries. So if you just exercise more responsibility on this, and I think that they can evolve into a better company and a better platform for most people. Mm-hmm. We already have a partnership with them. No? So we already have a partnership with Facebook. We already have a partnership with TikTok, also with Google for YouTube. And we're trying to fight this. We're actually telling them maybe become more involved in moderating your own platform. In some cases, we actually already help some journalists take down malicious content, those that mimic them, false videos that they didn't really do. I do not want to name the journalists, but some of them are from ABS-CBN, some are from other ABC5,
sure.
And some are from CNN also.
Mm-hmm.
So we're coordinating, but you know it's only a handful of people trying to moderate an entire internet. The other problem, Carmina, is that the internet does not forget. Even though they take it down, some people would have already downloaded it. Some people would have already taken videos of it. And there is what is called an internet cache that persists for like 5 years or 10 years. So even though we take it down, they're still there somewhere in the vestiges of the internet.
All right. A while ago, we mentioned about people falling for scams. It's sort of a test if you're going to fall for the bigger scam, which is actually controlling the outcome of elections, whatever country we're talking about, right? But how is the Philippines faring here in terms of falling for these scams? And when you talk about that, how vulnerable are we really when you talk about the 2025 elections and falling for misinformation and disinformation, Undersecretary? Don't mix words. Go ahead.
I think we're doing a better job now. If you look at the West Philippine Sea issue, I think that by involving journalists there, we are actually controlling the narrative. I think also that making people more involved in this social media content will help us control the narrative. As long as the narrative is neutral, it does not favor any particular political faction, even those from us in government, then we'll be able to resolve this issue. So if you ask me how do we fare, then the answer is we're faring better now. We're improving, but we're still very prone. So remember that the Philippines is still the third largest Facebook user in the world. Even though Facebook is quite old.
I know.
I think our daughters and our children are now using Instagram, which is a subsidiary of Facebook.
If you throw in generative AI into the mix, even if we're faring better now, and you say you see an acceleration leading up to 2025, are we prepared? Is there enough information and media literacy going around to sort of stave off any potential threats? Go ahead.
I think we should do better, especially in TikTok. There's a lot of AI-generated TikTok content, and also in Facebook. And we need to inform the people regarding this. In fact, we're also pushing for legislation regarding the use of AI in fraud. Not fraud. Actually, disinformation is a gray area when it comes to law, because you're not technically violating anything. So impersonating a media personality or a politician in order to misinform the public, we are also pushing for legislation on that. So basically, we need to do more. We need to do additional legislation when it comes to curbing misinformation. We need to form voluntary alliances with like-minded people and media groups so that we can curb off misinformation. In fact, I would invite ANC that we form this, maybe the private sector would be better off to form this alliance so that you can say that this is where actual news should come from, and don't listen to other sources because those are misinformation and disinformation.
Definitely more conversations like this. DICT Undersecretary Jeffrey D there joining us this noon. Really appreciate you coming to the show. Take care.
Thank you.
All right, from there, we're going to take a quick break. Up ahead, local fuel prices. We'll see mixed movements this week. The details when we return. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC. More news. Extreme heat being felt in parts of the Philippines forces some areas to call off classes today. Iloilo City Mayor Jerry Tremia suspended classes today and tomorrow from preschool to senior high school in both public and private schools. The heat index in Iloilo City today reaching 41 degrees Celsius. The municipality of Tantangan in South Cotabato also suspended afternoon in-person classes because of the hot weather. Over in Cebu City, dozens of mountain villages placed under a state of calamity because of dry conditions. Our very own Annie Perez joins us now with that story. Annie, over to you.
Hi, Carmina. The Cebu City Council has approved to place 28 mountain barangays under a state of calamity due to the effects of the El Nino. Councillor Joel Garganera, who is the chairman on Disaster Risk Reduction and Management, made the resolution which was approved in mass motion. Garganera said that the rainfall condition of these areas are way below normal. The rainfall are experiencing way below normal level. The basis for the declaration was a report by the Cebu City Agricultural Department saying that the Butuanon River upstream and the Kotkot-Lusaran River have experienced reduced stream flows. Dam water levels and groundwater due to less rainfall have logged at least 50% of production areas and has also shown presence of soil cracks in agricultural areas due to lack of water. The Cebu City Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council also issued a recommendation for the same declaration. The council says they are now looking into implementing immediate measures and interventions to help affected constituents cope with the situation. Under the state of calamity, the city can make necessary purchases to undertake critical, urgent, and appropriate measures in order to mitigate the ill impacts of El Nino. Joey Baclayon, meanwhile, the Cebu City agriculturist already earlier said that they will propose more hoses, drums, and other means to procure water for the farmers in these mountain barangays. They're also looking into providing alternative crops and other means of livelihood for affected individuals. Cebu City Mayor Michael Rama said that the declaration is a formality, but they already long prepared for this phenomenon. In the past days, the heat index in Cebu ranged from 34 degrees to 38 degrees Celsius, which is already under the danger category. And that's the latest here from Cebu City. Annie Perez, ABS-CBN News.
Thanks a lot. Annie Perez there joining us on the line back here in the newsroom. Mixed movement in pump prices set in the first week of April. Gasoline prices will once again go up, this time by 45 centavos. Kerosene, on the other hand, set to be cheaper by a peso and 5 centavos. Diesel will also see a 60 centavo rollback. Aside from pump prices, the cost of cooking gas also going down by 30 centavos to as much as 1 peso per kilo starting today, April 1st. We're going to take another break. Still ahead, France identifies hundreds of people as security threats ahead of the Paris Olympics. More on that when we come back. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC. And we are back with a check on the weather. ABS-CBN's resident meteorologist Ariel Rojas now joins us to tell us more about the extreme heat being felt in parts of the country today. Ariel, over to you.
Good afternoon, Carmina. Most of the country will continue to drizzle this Monday. Yesterday, temperatures in some parts of the archipelago exceeded 38 degrees Celsius for the first time this year. 38.4 degrees Celsius was recorded in Tuguegalau City, Cagayan, the hottest yet this warm and dry season. San Jose Occidental, Mindoro, meanwhile, logged 38.3 degrees Celsius. Today and for most of the week, the ridge or extension of a high-pressure area reaches the eastern parts of northern and central Luzon, while the warm and moist easterlies prevails over the rest of the Philippines. But as a forecast, dangerous level of heat index or feels like heat in some areas. 43 degrees Celsius in Apari, Cagayan and Tataraman, Northern Samar, while Pilica Marina Sur and Zamboanga City may experience 42 degrees Celsius. Heat stroke is probable if exposure to such conditions is continued. The public is reminded to wear comfortable clothing, use umbrella or other sun protection, do away from strenuous activities at noontime and afternoon, and hydrate frequently to prevent heat stress. Metro Manila will be hot and dry with no to very little chance of rain today. Afternoon thunderstorms may be experienced in some areas of the country, especially the Ilocos provinces and the northwestern part of Cordillera Administrative Region. So the latest on the weather, this is Ariel Rojas. Back to you, Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Ariel Rojas, there joining us on the line. World News Now, Pope Francis calls for an immediate ceasefire in Gaza and the release of all Israeli hostages as he presides over the Easter Sunday Mass at St. Peter's Square. The Pope's Easter message traditionally focuses on world affairs, and he marked the most important day on the Christian calendar by deploring the suffering caused by wars. The pontiff also mentioned other flashpoints, including Ukraine, Syria, Lebanon, Myanmar, and Haiti.
My thoughts go especially to the victims of the many conflicts worldwide, beginning with those in Israel and Palestine, and in Ukraine. May the risen Christ open a path of peace for the war-torn peoples of those regions. May the risen Christ open a path of hope to all those who in other parts of the world are suffering from violence, conflict, food insecurity, and the effects of climate change. May the Lord grant consolation to the victims of terrorism in all its forms.
The Pope has been in poor health in recent weeks, but took part in some Holy Week events. After the service, the Pontiff also took time to greet the massive crowd that had gathered at the Vatican. Well, despite the Pope's plea, there seems to be no let-up in Israel's offensive. The Israeli military claims to have killed a Hezbollah commander as it releases a video of airstrikes in several locations inside Lebanon. It identified the target as Ismail al-Zayn, a commander in the anti-tank missile unit of Hezbollah's Radwan forces. He is said to be responsible for dozens of attacks on Israeli civilians, communities, and security forces. Meanwhile, Gaza health officials and Hamas media report an Israeli airstrike hit several tents inside the Al-Aqsa hospital, killing four people and injuring several others, including some journalists. The Israeli military says it carried out an airstrike against a command center of the Islamic Jihad. France excludes some 800 people from the Paris Olympics over security fears. The list includes 15 deemed to represent the most serious threat to national security. France's interior minister says among those excluded are radical Islamists and radical environmental activists who want to hold protests. French security forces are screening up to 1 million people before the Summer Games, including athletes and people living close to key infrastructure. Switching gears now, here's a story about strengthening bonds through a shared meal. The Antwerp residents sat together on a 2-kilometer-long table to celebrate the Muslim Iftar and Christian Easter. The event was the second such community dinner in the Belgian city. Last year, around 2,500 sat down at a 1-kilometer-long table. This year, the table doubled in length to host up to 7,000 people. The mayor of Antwerp says the initiative is about inclusion and connection among cultures in times of tensions and polarization on a global level. And before we go, the latest installment in the Godzilla X-Kong Monsters Saga has arrived, but is it worth the trip to the cinemas? Here's Manny the Movie Guy with his verdict.
From director Adam Wingard, the guy who gave us Godzilla vs. Kong, the filmmaker seems to take inspiration from the Godzilla movies from the 60s and 70s. Less on the plot and more on the monster action.
I just love the sequences where the monsters are interacting with
probably horrendous.
Godzilla won't come down here unless Kong brings him.
As expected, the humans take a backseat for the monsters to shine, so actors like Dan Stevens, Rebecca Hall, and Brian Tyree Henry are used just to move the plot forward and to say horrible lines.
They're beloved and they're literally larger than life, which is cinema itself.
Yes, this movie is big, but it's only made for those who love their Titans clash. But for those who love meaningful plots against the monster mash like Godzilla Minus One, you're out of luck. Just leave your brain out the door and embrace your inner Titan. And for Godzilla fans, you may be this 2.5 out of 4 roar kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC.
And that'll do it for today. Thanks for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to visit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on our YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep well. Keep it tuned to the news channel.
To go.